Mr. Fly, thank you very much for your time and the combined effort from the Radio Liberty to support Georgia by setting up and reinforcing professional standards that have been exemplary for the Georgian media throughout the years. Thanks again and welcome to our program.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
My first question is about the worsening situation of media freedom around the world. As time goes, the job of a journalist is becoming more and more dangerous. Reporters Without Borders reported 70 journalists killed, a few hundred injured, and over 300 imprisoned in last 6 months. As we speak, more and more reporters and the cameramen are becoming subject to threats and intimidation. In your opinion, what should be the answer to this from the media outlets and organizations?
Yeah, I think it's an important question, and it's a challenge that we see every day across the 23 countries where Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty has local outlets. We see governments, many authoritarian governments, assaulting journalists. We see even democratic leaders who want to maintain their grip on power in a democracy and understanding that information is power, that shaping a narrative can help advance their political objectives. They target journalists because they don't like to be held accountable. They don't like the role that the independent media plays in supporting democracy. And so it's a very concerning trend. I think that news organizations need to speak out, need to work together to respond to challenges like some of those that we've seen here in Georgia. We need democratic governments, the United States, European governments, to take a stronger stand and speak out when journalists are being abused and assaulted. And we also need audiences to respond to this because audiences should also want the media to be able to function, to be able to be objective, and to hold their political leaders accountable. And so when we face these challenges, that's a lot of what I do and spend my time trying to raise awareness about the situation that our journalists face, but also urge governments and other actors, international groups, to speak out and to press these governments to stop assaulting journalists.
Mr. Fly, we already mentioned the situation in Georgia. And I think it's very interesting that you are visiting in a very difficult time for Georgian media, really. Step by step, day by day, situation is worsening. My second question, as you are aware of, on 5th July in central Tbilisi, there was a violent crackdown on the journalists and the cameramen by the extremist groups encouraged by Georgian government and some church representatives. The police failed to protect them, and as a result, more than 53 journalists were injured, including ones from Radio Liberty. A cameraman from TV Pirveli, Lekso Lashkarava, died a few days later. Many of us are leaving the impression that the Georgia is becoming more similar to Belarus or Russia. Do you have similar feelings? As I know, you had a meeting with the Georgian Prime Minister, Mr. Garibashvili, whose statement in the morning on 5th July gave a green light to the violence. As for now, none of the violence organizers are detained. Did you discuss this issue with him? If yes, how did he respond, and what was your impression?
Yeah, I did discuss it with him, and I made clear that I was very concerned, obviously, about what happened on July 5th, not just because three of our journalists from Tavasu Pleba were directly affected, but many of our colleagues at other news organizations, including yours, obviously were assaulted as well, many with significant injuries. I know I've heard about injuries that some of those journalists have that they'll have to endure for the rest of their lives. And then obviously the one other colleague who now lost his life afterwards. That's unacceptable anywhere. It's unacceptable in Russia. It's unacceptable in Belarus, where we do see these sorts of thuggish tactics. And I told the Prime Minister, as a longtime friend of Georgia and someone who's been following Georgia for many years, it's even more unacceptable in a democracy These are not the sorts of things that you would expect to be happening on the streets of Tbilisi. In a democratically in a country where you have a democratically elected government, it should embrace the free flow of information, the role that media plays in supporting democracy. And I urged him to hold those, not just who conducted the actual attacks, and I know a number of people have already been arrested, but to target those who actually organized and funded the attacks and hold them accountable. Because until that happens, it's a very dangerous situation where it, I know many journalists I've talked to during my several days here, don't even feel safe going out and covering public events. Some of that also goes to lowering the political rhetoric. And I had a number of meetings with political figures here about that topic. When you have hate speech, when you have politicians also making statements that appear to be inciting violence against journalists, that also fans the flames of a toxic situation. And so I do hope that the Georgian government will truly investigate who was ultimately behind these attacks and hold them accountable. And I think, as we've seen some statements from European governments and the United States government, that there's a lot of interest in this issue, and I think those governments will also continue to engage the Georgian government on this topic.
You mentioned Georgian government, and meanwhile, Georgian government representatives boycott critical media in Georgia, including our TV channel. They brand journalists from the critical TV outlets as a political actors and refuse to give interviews or participate in our talk shows. Although we do our best to have the government party views heard in our news shows to keep the balance, this makes it very difficult for us to properly function. I know Radio Liberty has vast experience of operating in an increasingly difficult environment. Based on your experience, what would be your advice to the Georgian media and the ruling party, which openly declared to apply to EU membership in 2024?
Yeah, we do see this trend across many countries, and government officials, when they don't like the criticism that they're getting or the tough questions or the work of investigative journalists, they start to boycott. They refuse to answer questions. We face it in many places. I've had many conversations both with democratically elected leaders as well as authoritarian governments where I invite them to do interviews with us. I say, you know, it's not going to be an easy interview. We're not going to just ask you, as we would say in the US, softball questions. We'll ask real questions about real issues. But that's part of democracy, being asked questions, being held accountable. It's certainly the case when democratically elected officials engage with their voters, and the media can play a part in that process. So to news organizations, what our approach is no matter how many times we get denied an interview or how many times we get an answer of no comment, we continue asking. I think it is important that news organizations continue trying to present all sides. Even when the government in question is not engaging, try to present viewpoints. If the government is not sending a representative, maybe finding an outside expert who has a similar view, who can at least defend some of the government's policies. Those are all things that we at Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, try to do across our markets. Because if you don't do that as a news organization, I think you make it easier for the government then to criticize you and just claim that you have a partisan bias that you're trying to deploy in that particular situation.
We all heard the story how Radio Liberty was branded foreign agent in Russia, which created additional troubles for you to operate, including the asset freeze. I'm interested in how Radio Liberty managed to continue work in such conditions. Did you change the way you deliver and disseminate the information under increasing pressure from the Russian authorities?
No, we're still able to produce news and information for the Russian people. We have a network of hundreds of journalists we work with across Russia. We've been in Russia for more than 30 years. We've had a bureau in Moscow. We were invited there by President Yeltsin in 1991. But ever since Vladimir Putin took office, he has targeted us with an increasing set of regulations. Most recently, this foreign agent framework, which is an attempt to label us and our journalists as spies. Our journalists are Russians. They care deeply about their country. They're just trying to do independent journalism for the Russian people. But now you've seen the Kremlin use the foreign agent label not just to try to close our office, freeze our bank accounts. We now owe $3.5 million in fines, which we're not going to pay. But he's also trying to put out of business other independent media outlets, like we've seen Medusa and a number of others targeted. And it's all about control. It's about controlling the information space, because Vladimir Putin ultimately is afraid of the Russian people, and he's afraid of free and open conversation about the way that he and his allies are running Russia. So we're going to do everything we can, even if our office is closed, to continue to provide news information to the Russian people. And I'm convinced, despite these efforts, that we'll be able to do that. And we've seen the Russian people respond by coming to our content more and more, especially online in recent years. There's a hunger in Russia for objective information that's not manipulated and controlled by the Kremlin. And we think we can fill that need that the Russian people have.
Mr. Flay, the Russian propaganda is a widespread problem in many countries in Europe and the world, Central and Eastern European, as well as former Soviet countries, are primarily target of the Russian propaganda, of course, including Georgia. One of the reasons for the violent crackdown on journalists and the sexual minorities on 5th July in Tbilisi was the radicalization and hatred brought around to the brains of regular Georgians by the Russian propaganda. In your opinion, what should be the steps that responsible media could take to efficiently counteract and neutralize Russian propaganda and disinformation?
I think the key is by maintaining objectivity and independence. The Russian playbook, and we've seen it in many countries, and Georgia's one case, but it's repeated time after time, is not even necessarily to always advance a specific narrative. They may make one particular argument in Georgia, Ukraine, they'll make the opposite argument. In Germany, they'll advance a different narrative. They want to create chaos. They want to spread conspiracy theories. They ultimately want to convince the Georgian people or whatever citizens they're aiming their propaganda at that there is no truth, that everything should be questioned.
Yeah, that's what is happening now in Georgia.
And that is a truly dangerous situation, as we're seeing a bit here. But in any country, when people believe that there's no truth, that they follow conspiracy theories, they lose faith in their political leaders, they ultimately lose faith in democracy. And that is Vladimir Putin's goal. And from what I've heard, there were Russian outlets in the wake of July 5th pointing to Georgia, saying, see, democracy is chaos, democracy is a failed experiment. That ultimately is the broader narrative that they are trying to spread in the United States and Western Europe, as well as in places like Georgia. And that's why independent journalists are so important. And that's why Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty is active in all of these countries to work with other independent media outlets to prop up the truth, to ensure that there is objective information that's available to audiences, and that they don't continue to lose faith and confidence in the broader information system. But it's a significant challenge, especially given how people now interact with news and information in a variety of ways, especially online.
After the annexation of Crimea, you opened the Russian-speaking TV channel as part of Radio Liberty, similar to the Russian-speaking peak TV channel we had in Georgia. Mm-hmm. How efficient is this channel? Don't you think it was a bit too late, as Russian propaganda had already done the job there?
Yeah, I do think that in the company, and I was not involved in U.S. broadcasting at the time, but I do think that the company could have pivoted earlier to come up with new ways to reach our Russian audience. We feel, though, that current time, our Russian channel has been incredibly successful. It's one of the reasons, to be honest, that we're now being targeted by the Kremlin. They are fearful of the content that we produce and the reach that we've had, especially with young Russians online, covering what is going on inside Russia, but also for a Russian audience outside of the Russian Federation. And one of our goals now as a company is to ensure that we do not fall behind the media trends, like every news organization, that we're adapting and we're evolving and we're relevant for our audiences as they move to new platforms, as they move not just online, but to a variety of social media platforms. And so we're hoping that even as we continue to see these assaults on the truth across many of our markets, that we will be able to provide news and information to our audiences on the platforms where they are planning to go in the years to come. But we think that our current time network will be part of that, and a lot of what they're doing is also now expanding onto online platforms and is not just delivered in the same way it traditionally was on TV. Yeah.
Radio Echo Kavkaza in Georgia partly covers Abkhazia and South Ossetia too. Do you think the voices of all of the sides are well heard, and does it have good enough coverage of the Russian occupied territories?
We believe that is an important project in these areas that have basically become captive to Russian occupation and also an information assault from Moscow. We're very committed to Echo Kavkaz. We can always redouble our efforts and try to reach those audiences. We have some experience doing this, including in Russian-occupied Crimea, but it's a difficult audience to reach. Given the almost total information control that Moscow uses as part of its political occupation. They go to every length to try to pressure people and try to get them to stop working with us, to pressure our freelancers, to intimidate them. In Crimea, for instance, right now, we actually have one of our colleagues who works for our Ukrainian service who was detained several months ago by the KGB. Has been charged basically as a terrorist, false charges. He was a journalist doing nothing more than trying to collect information about what was going on in Crimea, share it both with Crimeans as well as with other Ukrainians. And so this is something we'll continue to adapt and ensure that we can reach those audiences, because quite frankly, they need access to the truth more than many of our audiences. Thankfully, in Georgia, Ukraine, other places we operate, those audiences have a diverse set of options. But in many of these areas, including South Ossetia and Abkhazia, they're presented with essentially Putin propaganda and maybe only one or two other options. And so our role is incredibly important. We're very committed to it.
And the last question regarding ongoing situation in Georgia, in particular regarding the media, what you will say to Georgian journalists in this very problematic situation where to do your job, it's directly linked with the safety of your activity. Why journalism is important for the country, for development of Georgia society, for our integration in the EU Atlantic system, and how the West watches the situation in Georgia, and what role of ordinary Georgian journalists are playing in this very important process.
Georgian journalists are playing an essential role right now in this tumultuous environment. I think the continued objectivity is important to try to not get swept up into the politics, which I think those who want to attack the credibility of journalists, actually hoping that they become more politicized, it makes it easier to attack them. But journalists everywhere, and especially here at moments like this, I think are playing a role of being a pillar in Georgian democracy, and it's essential that they, despite the risk, continue to do their jobs. Now, obviously, we, given our work at Tavu Supleba, are going to try to work with other news organizations to figure out how journalists can band together here to protect themselves. Obviously, people should take whatever precautionary measures are necessary for their own physical safety. And we will also use the platform that we have to advocate for the rights of all Georgian journalists, just like I did earlier this week with the Prime Minister and other officials. And I told the Prime Minister that we'll continue to engage on this, especially during this difficult period in the run-up to the October elections, which is key. And we'll make sure, given our funders in Congress and their interest in Georgia, that they're aware of the situation, and that European governments also pay more attention and speak out when they see journalists being threatened.
Once again, I would like to thank you for your visit and the support in such hard times, when the situation is getting worse on a daily basis and the Georgian media stands as a last bastion in support of Georgia's failing democracy. We hope that our Western friends will become more active to prevent Georgia from derailing the path to democracy as you are doing. So thank you again, and I hope that your next visit in Georgia for Georgian media will be better.
I hope so too. Thanks, it was great to be with you.
Thank you very much.